Hello, it's Keith here, and welcome to the Hello World series. This week we're going to be looking at the NES, also known of course as the Famicom, basically the same system. We're going to learn today how to do a simple Hello World message onto the screen, build a simple cartridge, and you know, just get you very, very early on started with a simple cartridge that you can run and say you managed to build yourself. So let's go over and take a look at the code we're going to be looking at today. And here it is. So we'll fire this straight away up and let's see it in action, just prove it really works. And so here you can see we've got a nice Hello World message here on a blue screen with some yellow text. And this is a font we've created ourselves. So this is what we're going to be learning how to do today. Now, the first thing with the NES cartridge is it does have a little header here. Our code starts at BFF0, but really the program execution will be at the C000 range. This is just a sort of generic header. We're just defining our cartridge here. We're defining a memory mapper. We're defining some extra VRAM. That's not something that's standard on a cartridge, but it's going to be something that's going to make things a lot easier for us programming, because otherwise we'd be working with ROM. So that's what we'll be doing there. As well as the header at the start, there's also kind of a footer at the end here. This defines three addresses. Program start, the first line of our code. The NMI, the non-maskable interrupt handler, this is quite important. This will be something known as V-blank, which is when the screen's not drawing. We'll discuss that in a moment. And an IRQ handler, which we don't need, but we do need to define something. So we are doing that just up here. Now we're defining a few zero page entries here. These are symbols pointing to bits of memory, and we're just using these as a visual convenience. So we're defining one as being called V-blanked. And this is going to be used to detect when the system is in V-blank. That's when the screen is not drawing. We're just altering the value in this address, and then we can test for that to see when the V-blank has occurred, because this is an interrupt handler. This will interrupt and the processor will change that value. The IRQ handler doesn't do anything, and it's just returning from the interrupt just here. Cursor X and cursor Y. Now, if you think of your basic programming language, you've got the locate command, and you're specifying an X and a Y position for the next character to draw. On the NES, it's a tile sprite system. We've got no firmware to do that kind of thing for us, so we're going to define our own font, and then we're going to define the positions in the tile map to show the characters from that font. So we're going to use this XY position as the next character we want to draw on the screen, the position. So that's what we're going to need it for. And here's the start of our program. So first of all, we're just turning off interrupts, clearing the decimal flag, and setting up the stack with the default position. And then we're enabling some extra RAM just here. Probably won't need that in this example, but it's a good thing to have. Now, once we've done that, we're going to start turning on our screen. First of all, we're going to zero the X and Y position, just in case they aren't zero from the start. And then we're going to define the first address in VRAM that we want to write to. We do this with a pair of writes to memory address 2006, which is the PPU address port. The first one's the high address, the second one's the low address, but we just want to set it to zero. So we've got A already zero here, so we're just writing zero twice there. And that gets us in a position where we're ready to start sending data to the PPU into the pattern data that makes up the possible patterns for tiles. We've got a bitmap font that we're going to use. It's the font I use in all of the bitmap examples. Where is it? There it is. And it's got 96 characters, the first one being space. It's 1 bit per pixel, a black and white font. But in these tutorials, we actually use color 0 for the background or 3 for the foreground of the font, at least on a 4-color system. On a 16-color system, we'd use color 15 and so on. So what do we need to do? Well, we've selected our destination address here, and we've now got our font. But what we need to do now is do all 768 lines, hexadecimal 300, and we need to write the bit data into what are known as the bit planes. On the NES or Famicom, a bit plane is basically where we've split the bits. So a 4-color system will use 2 bits to define each color, but they're actually split so that each line, all the bit zeros are in one area and all the bit ones are in one area. Bit weird, I know, but don't worry about it. If you're not too familiar with that, you won't really need it too much at early stages anyway, because if you're using my sprite editor, it'll just output the data you need. And if you're doing something like this and you've got example code, you can just use example code without worrying too much, but it's not too bad a concept anyway. So what we're doing here is we're using X as a high counter and Y as a low counter here, and we're effectively repeating loading the data into both of the bit planes with this do bit plane function here. And here it is. All it does is it does the 8 lines of the font, it writes them to the PPU data port, which will write to the address previously selected, automatically incrementing when it does, and it's just repeating until the X reaches 0 here. And you can see, so that will have effectively done one character into one bit plane. And then if you look at our code here, once we've done the one character into one bit plane, we're resetting Y from the stack and writing the same character into the second bit plane, because both bit planes will now be 0 or 1. The result is that the color will be 0 or 3. And that's what we do to set our font up. That's got our font nice and set up there. Again, we use the PPU address, but this time, instead of memory address 0, we're using 3F00, which defines the palettes. We're defining the first palette, and we're going to define some colors for that. And the colors are just here. They're actually backwards, because it was more convenient to use the X register in that way. So this is color 0, which is a sort of dark blue, you could see before. And this is a yellow, and that's what we're doing here. Colors 1 and 2 aren't used in this example, but they are set up just because it was easier to not than not setting them up, because we're using a loop here. So we're just repeatedly reading in from the palette here, storing them to 2007 like before, and that, because we're now writing to 3F00, that's the video address for the palette data, and that sets up our colors. Now, at all of these times, we've been writing to straight to video memory, but that's because the screen at this stage isn't on. If the screen is on, then we can't just write to video memory. We'd need to check if we're in VBank. Now, at this stage, though, we do want to turn the screen on, and we're going to be actually showing things to the user. And so that's what we're doing here. We're just turning on the screen, and then we're enabling the VBank interrupt, which is going to bring this code into play. And we're going to need that next time we try and write to the screen. Okay. So how do we actually print our characters to the screen? Well, it's this bit of long code here. It's a bit tricky, I know, but that's what's required. So what we're going to do is we're going to calculate a memory address within the tile map. The tile map is the visible screen, in effect, that we're seeing here. And we're going to work out the position we want to draw to next, and then we're going to change that tile to represent the pattern of the font that we want to show. Now, our font starts at the character space, which is character 32. So character 32 is tile number 0. So to affect that, we subtract 32 from the character we've been asked to show. We then store that into 0 page entry 26 here. We're then backing up X and Y just for a moment. And we're going to load in the cursor X and Y position here. And we're going to calculate the memory address of the tile that's represented by the XY position that we want to show. And the formula is just here. It's hexadecimal 2000, because that's the base address in video RAM of the tile map. And then the Y position times 32, because there's 32 tiles on each line, plus the X position. And you don't have to multiply the X position, because there's just one byte per tile on the NES. So how are we doing that? With bit shifts, because the 6502 has no multiply commands, but if we shift something to the left once, we effectively double it. If we shift it twice, we effectively multiply it by 4, 3 times by 8, and so on. And that's what we're doing here. So we're splitting up the bits here. We're doing some bit shifts. We're doing the low byte here, and we're adding the X position. So we've effectively done this part and part of this part. Then we do the high bits, and we add the 20, effectively adding hexadecimal 2000. And we're storing that in X here. Now, because the screen's on this time, we need to wait for VBank. You see, whenever we write to video memory, we can only do that in VBank, or things are going to get very, very weird. Now, the way we wait for VBank is just here. We're writing a 0 to the VBlanked definition, which is a symbol that is entered in the 0 page, and then we wait for it to change. Well, the loop here is not going to change it, so what will? Well, if you look at before, the interrupt handler we defined just here is going to increment that VBlank, and that's what's going to change it. So as soon as that changes, that VBlank must have occurred, and that's what we're relying on here. So we're waiting for our VBlank, and once we get it, we then write our X and Y here, which contain the high and low bytes of the address we want to change, and then we write the new value for that address just here, which is what we calculated here. So that will now have drawn the character to the screen. It's not just VBlank that's the problem, though. Whenever we write to the screen, the scrolling of the tile map will actually change and it will go wrong. And so we need to write the new X and Y positions, which are 0 and minus 8, and we write those to 2005. We just write the X position first and the Y position second, and that will set the new position of the scroll map, which is what we want to see for this layout here, which I think is going to be easiest for you. Once we've done that, we just check if we've reached the end of the screen, character 32, and if we have, we do a new line. And the new line is just here, loading a 0 into X and incrementing Y. Now, all of that's a bit of a pain, and it's going to be quite slow as well, because we're waiting for VBlank every write to the screen, which is not efficient. What we really want to do is define a buffer and transfer that entire buffer during the VBank interrupt. Now, I've covered that in my platform specific series, but it's far too complicated for this. This example is really just intending to show you how to get some very simple text onto the screen just as an early example. So it's beyond the scope of this. Now, that's how we're getting a character to the screen, but in my tutorials, we extend that into printing a string to the screen. And the way I've done that here is we are using a character 255 terminated string. We're loading in from addresses 20 and 21 in the zero page, which is the address of the string, reading in a character, sending it to print chart until we get to our 255, at which point we give up. That's how we print to the screen. Okay, so that's how we're printing this to the screen, and you've seen the result of it here. It's a bit complicated, but I think this is a relatively easy way of getting things working on the NES. Hopefully it's going to be of some interest. Now, once I've got Hello World onto the screen, whenever I'm programming a new system, I then extend it a little bit and I add some simple debugging tools. And this example here, we'll use a monitor and a memdump. Now, we're not going to go into the details of this, but effectively all we need to do is include a basic macros function and also include the monitor tools here. If I fire this up, we'll see the result. And so here it is. So now we've got the registers shown to the screen, A, X and Y, the stack, the flags and the program counter, and we've dumped some memory here. And you can see in the code here, this is the command that dumped the monitor, and this is the one that showed the memory to the screen. So this will probably help you out if you're just getting started and you need a way of checking out that things are running as expected. For example, our program code looks like it should start at hexadecimal C000, and we can confirm that if we just look at the program counter. It looks like that's probably correct. We could even dump the memory and just double check that it's been loaded in correctly as we expected. So that's how we can do a basic Hello World and how we can extend it a little bit with some debugging tools. Now, of course, some emulators will have better debugging tools, but I've come to not rely on that kind of thing because they're so often missing from emulators. So it's like, well, stick to what you know and stick to things you can trust. And it's a good practice if you're learning programming and if you're learning a new system. I get a lot of sense of self-achievement when I manage to get PDP-11, for example, to run the similar tools. It really is quite satisfying. So that's what I always do first. So we've learned how to do a Hello World example and do some simple tools. But of course, there is another stage to the procedure. If we're going to compile a cartridge, we've actually got to assemble our ASM file. Now, I always use VASM for this, 6502 VASM in old style mode. And here's the batch file that I use to build the program. So we'll go through the contents of this and explain what each section does. So that if you're using VASM, you can write your own scripts if you don't want to use mine, because all of this is downloadable on my website. But if you don't want to, I'll show you how to write your own script. So the first thing we're specifying here, this %1, this is the source file. So the helloworld.asm or whatever, the batch file uses this as %1. I'm specifying to check labels. This is a clever trick. VASM will detect if you've accidentally forgot the tab on a command. So if you put a return command at the far left of the screen without a tab, it will look like a label. And VASM will say, hey, I think that label is probably wrong. It doesn't quite say it like that, but that's what it means. And so that will really save you some debugging time, because if it didn't tell you that, you'd be wondering why your program was crashing in it, because your return was being mistaken for a label called return and things. I'm disabling case sensitivity. I'm a Windows person. I'm all too slack with my case for not disabling it. Defining a symbol called VASM. You don't need that. That's just for my purposes. Sometimes later on, I will occasionally have to move to a different assembler. And so if that assembler has partially different syntax, it allows me to have different branches for different systems. But that's not one you need. This build NES one, you won't need for the basic Hello World, but you probably will for the monitor. Some of my code is able to run on multiple systems, and so I define a symbol for each system so I can have conditional code that only runs on the NES, only runs on the SNES, etc. This is a listing file. This is for debugging. A listing file will show the source code and the output bytes. You only need it if you're in real trouble and you know what you're looking for, but it is really fascinating for educational purposes, because sometimes if you're really stuck, you'll find out why you were going wrong there. And other times, if things are acting oddly and you don't understand why, you might find, I found a lot with the 68002s, that the assembler was actually doing a lot of optimization, and what I was expecting things to compile to wasn't what they were actually compiling to, and it was totally throwing me all over the place. So it can be very helpful on the days you will need it, but generally not something you absolutely need just to start. We need to output a binary file, and we need to specify a name for the file, which is cart.nes. And once we've built that cartridge, assuming there were no errors, we can just load it with Nestopia just by specifying cart.ness on the command line. That's all I've been doing today. This is the script I've been using for all of my tutorials. It's really quite easy to build an S cartridge if you've got a file in the same format as the one I've shown you today. And you should have one, because as I say, you can download all of this, all of the scripts, all the sources from my website. So please go ahead and do that. And there we go. It's a bit tricky on these tile sprite-based systems to get the hello world on the screen. Not as easy as a system with an operating system, but you know, it swings and roundabouts. Those systems, often you have a lot of trouble getting stuff to the disk. So I think the NES is a pretty decent system for you to get started on if you want to learn programming, and it's a popular system. So yeah, good idea from that point. Now, from the point of view of my tutorials, I've got lots of other NES tutorials already on my site. So please have a look at my YouTube channel. There's a playlist, or go onto my website and check out the page. Anyway, I hope you've enjoyed this. I hope you're going to have a go at programming the NES, or at least have a look at some of my other tutorials, because I think there's a lot to be learned from these old systems. Whatever you do, though, I hope you enjoy your programming and you enjoy playing with these old computers. Thanks for watching today, and goodbye.